already put that in the chat, but I was just gonna say talking with God,
Yes.
basically, you know, having a conversation with God. Yeah.
Thank you. Talking
And it's
with God.
mutual. I'm sorry. I wanted to say it's mutual. It's not just
Yes.
one way.
Yes, it's not just one person. Sister Jesus said talking to God. Sister O says communicating with God. Togo B is saying prayer is communicating with God. Precious, a conversation with God. Pastor Jerome says two-way communication with God. I speak, he listens, he speaks, and I listen. That's good. So Sister Timmy and Brother Jerome have the same answer. Very important that prayer is communication with God. It's not only you speaking. Have you ever been in a conversation where somebody is speaking and talking and talking and talking? After a while, you start getting bored because conversation-wise, it is a give and take, give and take. Same thing with God. When you pray, you are communicating with God. You speak, he listens. Then God speaks and you listen. So let's go into what prayer is. I said that prayer is not a religious expression or something you do to fulfill righteousness. There are other religions. I know there's a religion that prays at least 5 times a day. So in most religions, one of their credence is prayer. If you look at different religions, Buddhism, Hinduism, Islam, most of the credence that they have, most of their templates, most of what they have that they do is prayer. But our own prayer is different. We are communicating, we are praying to a supreme God. We are praying to the God of gods. We are praying to the King of kings. I want to let you know that you are not praying to a small person. You are not praying to somebody that is limited. You are not praying to somebody that does not have what it takes. You are praying to the one who can do things in your life. You are praying to the great I am that I am. May God continue to help us in Jesus' name. Prayer is intimacy. It's intimacy. I have not seen. If you see someone that prays and prays with their heart, they have an intimate relationship with God. They have an intimate relationship with God. Prayer is intimacy. Prayer is intimacy. Prayer is communion. You are communing with divinity. It is a place where you come and you leave your own realm. You leave the realm of the physical to a different realm, to the realm of divinity, to the realm of the spiritual. Have you ever prayed before and you just felt different? I don't know if that happened to you before. Or you are praying and you feel like you have ascended to a different realm. You are praying with your heart. You are praying so much that you don't feel like you are in this realm anymore. That's prayer. Prayer is a communication with God, is knowing the mind of God. Remember Abraham, when he was praying, and God told him that he was going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. And he started negotiating with God. You remember that story? He said, God, if there are only this set of amount of people in the land, will you destroy it? And God said, okay, I won't. God, if there's 10 people, we destroy it. I'm giving an example. He said, I won't. He negotiated that with God. He negotiated with God. He now said, God, if there's only one person who forgive me, God, will you destroy? And he said, no. Ah. So prayer is a place of negotiation. Prayer is a place where you negotiate. It's a place of interaction. You negotiate things of the spirit. It's a place where you negotiate your destiny. It's a place where you negotiate your finances. That's prayer. It's a place where you establish things. It's a place where you decree things that will happen and it happens. That's prayer. So you want God to bless you. You do not wish it. You negotiate it in the realm of the spirit and it happens with prayer. Zoom users say prayer is an invocation or act that seeks to activate a rapport with an object of worship through deliberate communication. That's very deep, sir. That's very elaborate. And I will say that prayer is very sweet when you pray in the Holy Ghost. I think it's Jude 120. Jude 120. Someone can post that for me. Jude 120. I believe that's the passage. He said that we should pray and pray in the Holy Ghost. Jude 120. Paul said, he said, I speak in tongues more than ye all. We have talked about this in the past. I don't want to dwell on it, but prayer is very effective when you pray in the Holy Ghost. When you pray, you understanding, there's a limitation. There's a limit to how you can pray. There's a limit to how you can respond. But when you pray in the Holy Ghost, you are edifying yourself. Thank you, Brother Peter. But ye beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. See, when you pray in the Holy Ghost sees ahead. You can be praying in tongues now. You are setting a course for your life in the next 10 years. That's praying in the Holy Ghost. You can be praying now. Okay, now let's say I want to pray for my brother. Father, I thank you for him. I thank you. I bless your holy name. Thank you, Jesus, for this. Thank you. No, that's good. But when you start saying in tongues, Father, I pray. What he needs most is thought and praying. I may not know, but praying the Holy Ghost goes to search the deep things of God and reveal it to you and me. That's prayer in the Holy Ghost. Nothing beats it. So if you are not filled with the Holy Ghost, pray this prayer and I say, Father, fill me with the Holy Ghost. Fill me with the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues. Pray that prayer in the next 5 seconds. Father, I take the infilling of the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues. See, the evidence of the Holy Spirit is not only speaking in tongues, but it's a great evidence. I don't have to say it. There are other evidences of speaking of the Holy Ghost, hearing him clearly, seeing clearly. But the one evidence of the Holy Ghost is speaking in tongues. Ah, you can't beat it. There's something about speaking in tongues that fires your spirit man. If your spirit man is low, don't speak in tongues. There's a way your spirit man is fired. Because of time, let's just keep going. Nothing beats prayer, but nothing beats praying in the Holy Ghost. Let's practice it. In the next 5 seconds, if you can meet yourself, let us pray in the Holy Ghost. If you don't mind, are you ready? Five.
Yes, sir. Four. Yes, sir.
Amen. You can have this back. Thank you. I also put here that prayer is not just a one-time thing, it's a continuous thing. James 5:16b. It says the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man, of a righteous woman. A village much. You know, when God used man, he's talking about both sex, male and female. Prayer is where transactions is made in the realm of the spirit. And of course, I put there, prayer is a command. Luke 18:1, men ought always to pray and not faint. Luke 18:1, prayer is a command. Prayer is a command. We have Jesus. If you look at examples in the Bible of men and women that prayed, Jesus prayed. Jesus prayed always. Before he picked the disciples, he prayed. You all remember that when before Jesus was born, we had Hannah. Hannah was in the temple. What was Hannah doing? Hannah was married for 7 years and she lost her husband. For the next, is it 80 years or so? I don't remember. Someone can give me the exact number. She was praying for the fulfillment of prophecy. So many of you, they have put prophecy on your head. They've decreed over you that you'll be a rich man. You'll be a wealthy woman. You'll be successful. My brother and sister, it only comes to fulfillment by prayer. It comes to fruition by prayer. If a prophet decrees over your life, you effect the decree by prayer. If a negative decree comes over you, you cancel that decree by prayer. May God help us in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen and amen. 19 years. Anna prayed in the temple for the fulfillment of God's prophecy. And if you know that Jesus was slain before the foundation of the world, for Jesus to come on earth, we need people to even pray that prayer. So you can see here that even for God to fulfill his destiny and for you to fulfill destiny, you need to be a man and a woman of prayer. I looked at Elisha. Elisha is a man that intrigues me, or is still intriguing me. That's the word to use. I look at the book of 2 Kings 4, 8 to 32. We don't have time to read everything, but I'll just read a bit of it and I put it there. 2 Kings 4, 8 to 32. When Elisha came to the house, there was the child lying dead on his bed. He went in, therefore, shut the door behind the two of them and prayed to the Lord. You remember that Elisha took over the mantle of Elijah. And before this happened, Elisha gave his staff to Gehazi to go and lay it on the child. But Gehazi was not carrying the right spirit. Gehazi was not a man of prayer. I think, don't quote me. I don't think Gehazi had the level of prayer life that Elisha had. Because the mantle or the staff that Elisha gave, if you remember the story very well, that this woman, the Shunammite woman, was a very wealthy woman. She used to feed Elisha. And of course, after a while, she started housing him. When he comes through that part of the city or the world, she will house him. Then one day, Elisha decreed over, he said, by this time next year, you have a child. And he said, please, don't whine me. Oh. Don't whine me. Because a lot of people have decreed over her life before and it did not happen. So this time she decreed, or Elisha decreed, and it came to pass. Now the guy or the son that she had died, that means that from the realm of the spirit, that woman was not meant to have any child. Hey, you hear what I'm saying? From the realm of the spirit, the enemy has proposed that she should be a wealthy woman with no child. This child was sick and died. But what happened? She practiced something called faith. When her husband asked her, what happened? She just started shouting, hey, I don't start to like, help me, help me, help me. She wasn't shouting. She said, all is well. Read that passage, 2 Kings 4, 8 to 32. It will explain it to you. She said something. He said, all is well. She now said, please give me someone that can ride very fast and take me, or ride a donkey, or what do you call it, a horse, whatever it is, and take me over to Elisha. And when Elisha go, when she go, when they go to Elisha, Elisha said that the Lord has not revealed what is wrong with this woman. And when, of course, when the child died, Elisha came into the house in verse 32 and prayed to the Lord. And when Elisha prayed, what happened? God answered the prayer of Elisha. If you look at the other one, Elisha, again, he cancels poison. In 2 Kings 4, 38 to 41, Elisha was with his guys and they were cooking and somebody got something. If you look at the verse 39. So one went out onto the field to gather herbs and found a wild vine and gathered from it a lapful of wild gourds and came and sliced them into the pot of stew, though they did not know what they were. Verse 40. Then they served it to the men to eat. Now it happened as they were eating the stew that they cried out and said, man of God, there is death in the pot, and they could not eat it. So he said, then bring some flour, and he put it into the pot and said, serve it to the people that they may eat. And there was nothing harmful in the pot. That is power. For you to think solutions quickly, that's power. And if you look at that same chapter in the previous passage, a widow woman came to him and said, Obadiah is dead and his own people. And what did Elisha say? He said, what do you have in your house? What would you think that Elisha will start raising money? Let's do fundraiser for an old prophet that has died. No. The wisdom of God was there. So I want to let you know that when you are a prayer person, you are a person filled with wisdom. When you pray often, you have the wisdom of God. So when situations come that seem impossible, God gives you wisdom on what to do. Elisha was a man of wisdom. Who gave Elisha the idea to use flour to cancel poison? Who gave Elisha the idea to lie down on that child and put his nose on the nose of that child, put his eyes on the eyes of that Shunammite woman's son, and bring to that child and speak to that child the wisdom of God? Same thing with the feeling of the 100 people men. What am I trying to say? That when you are a man or a woman given to prayer, you are not foolish. Proverbs 3, 5 to 6 says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him. The acknowledgement is prayer. In all your ways, acknowledge what? Him. And he will direct your path. If you are confused, you don't know what to do. You don't know what job to pick. You don't know who to marry. You don't know what to do. Pray. And the Lord himself will show you what to do in Jesus' name. Amen and amen and amen. I can give various examples, but I want to let you know that God is in the business of giving you wisdom. How do you get your prayers answered? Let me ask everyone here. How do you get your prayers answered? I want to hear you. How do you get prayers answered? Please, I need answers. And please don't forget to invite somebody. I'm seeing some people I've not invited, and I'm seeing some new people. Joseph, I'm seeing some new people. Please invite somebody right now. Invite somebody. We should be more than this. Invite somebody. How do you get your prayers answered? How? I'm going to call people. Guy, how do you get your prayers answered? What do you do? Do you have anything to say? Guy. Sister Bella says, praying the word of God. Very true. You're spying my notes. Very true. Sister Mayowa, how do you get your prayers answered? Sister Mayowa, are you there? Okay, next person, Yomi. How do you get your prayers answered? So Gubis is saying here that by praying with faith and praying the scriptures. Very true. You guys are spying to my notes. Speaking in tongues, by building strong faith. Once you know the will of God, which is the word of God, I'm praying in the Holy Spirit. Okay, good. I guess some of you will be revision. Let's go. How do you get your prayers? The first thing I put there is praise God. Psalm 40 verse 3. He put a new song in my mouth. A hymn of praise to our God. Many will see and fear the Lord and put their trust in him. I put here number one, praise is a powerful weapon. You know, there are different weapons. If you know your artillery, if you know you have an arsenal, you know, there are different guns. You have the pistol, the sniper, we have the AK-47, we have different guns, we have grenades. Praise is the most powerful weapon. Praise is like an intercontinental ballistic missile. Praise is the biggest bomb you ever know. Praise is a powerful weapon. Somebody was showing me today, and I realized in John 11:41, before Jesus rose or awake Lazarus from the dead, he gave thanks. He said, Father, I thank you because you hear me. Father, I thank you because you hear me. And Jesus gave thanks and he broke bread. And he fed how many thousands of people? Is it 5,000 men? Praise. Let me tell you the truth. The best time to exercise faith is when you are exercising faith for prayers that have not been answered. When you are dancing, you are thanking God for that visa. You are dancing and thanking God for finances. You are dancing and thanking God for your spouse. There are many examples I want to give, but one day I will give you this. Don't worry. Very soon, I will give you examples, personal ones. The best weapon for prayer is praise. Praise can bring forth miracles. Remember Jehoshaphat, when they praised God, and God sent ambushment against the enemy. Praise brings about the presence of God. When they were about to go to war, Elijah said, bring me a minstrel. And the minstrel praised and played, and the fire and the power of God and the presence of God came over Elisha, and he prophesied. He said, there will be ditches, but ditches will not be filled with water. He said, dig ditches. That is wisdom that comes from praise. I can give more and more examples. David was given to praise. David was a man that praised God. So if you want God to step into your situation, be a man or a woman that prays. Be a man that worships God. Be a woman that can praise God. You know, I've heard that praise is prayer. You're asking God, is it that you are stepping to the situation of God when you pray? And when you praise, God is stepping into your situation. Something like that. When you praise God, God steps into your situation. God steps into your presence. God comes into your atmosphere. He comes to domicile in your place. Be a man of praise. We are going to do something that sounds foolish. I want to make a joyful noise unto the Lord right now. We are going to unmute ourselves now and shout and make a joyful noise. Are you ready? In the next 5 seconds. 5, 4. Are you ready? 3, 2, 1. Shout. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Amen. You can move back. You can move yourself back. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Oh my God. Jesus.
Amen. Thank you. Praise is a powerful weapon. Y'all remember when they walked around the wall of Jericho, the children of Israel? They walk around 7 times. And I think at the 7th time, that's when they shouted and the wall of Jericho fell down flat. Let me tell you, your next miracle is in your praise. Your next miracle is in your praise. Many of you are saying, I've been praising God, I've not seen anything. Ah, it's your praise that has not made it worse. Let me tell you, if you have not seen, you know, I realize that when you are not seeing answers to your prayer, it does not mean that God is not working. See, if you don't see answers to your prayers, God is working behind the scenes. When you go to a restaurant and order food, You go to a gourmet restaurant and you order. Sometimes it takes 15 minutes, sometimes it takes 20 minutes, 30 minutes, depending on your order. You are waiting on your order does not mean that they are not cooking it in the kitchen. So same thing when you pray. When you pray, they are taking your order to the kitchen of God. God is working on it. He's putting spice. He's putting Maggi. He's putting thyme. He's putting all the mede-mede, all the onions. He's putting it there. But you are waiting and saying, God is not answering my prayer. God is working behind the scenes. God is already preparing a great meal for you. By the time the meal comes out, oh my gosh, it's the best tasting meal. God is saying to you and me, praise God in your time of waiting. God is working behind the scenes. You have been saying, God, I'm waited, I've waited, I've waited. God is working behind the scenes. Ephesians 3:20, he said, unto him that is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all we could ask or think. God is set to do great things. Let me give an example, and I'll give a quick example because of time. Some years ago, I was trusting God for a job. I was trusting God for an IT job, and I got one. And I was so happy. I said, thank you, Jesus. The job was in Minnesota. But not Minnesota is like, is it Midwest of the US? But it's not even like Minneapolis. Minneapolis is the capital of Minnesota. It's like northern Minnesota, like cold place. But me, I didn't mind. You know, when you have been jobless for a while, any job is good. I'm telling you, not any job. But when you get a good job, you say you should move to a state 10 hours away. You will move, at least just to keep body and soul together. So I was getting ready to move. I was even discussing with my parents on how I'll drive down to Minnesota. How then the woman called that the job is not available again. Eh? Eh? If she was there, I would have struggled. I'm not a violent person. Because they're already giving me false hope. They're going to make six figures. You are going to do this. You are going to do that. You are going to do this one. We are going to do this one. We are going to pay for this. So my mind already, I wasn't reading castle in the air. You now called and said, no job. Eh? Oh God. I won't lie, I was depressed though. You know, it's funny now, but it wasn't funny then. Because I didn't even mind going to northern Minnesota. I did not mind living near Canada. But you know, when God works things out, he will make it so much worthwhile. Some of you are here. You have talked to somebody. It did not work out. You have dated some people. It didn't work. You have applied for visa. It did not work. You have applied for jobs. It did not work. Some of you are living from hand to mouth. You are begging for bread. I want to assure you by the mercies of God that as you praise God, every embargo will be lifted in Jesus' name. Everything, every disappointment will turn to triumph in the name of Jesus. Say loud amen. Amen. So the first place of prayer is praise. Praise is a weapon that cannot be described. Let's look at one passage and I will stop because of time. This last chapter in the book of Psalms, Psalm 149, not the last, second to last chapter, Psalms 149, let's put our eyes on it. Psalms 149, from verse 5 to 9. Psalms 149, from verse 5 to 9. Psalms 149, from verse 5 to 9. Let the saints be joyful in glory. Woo! Let them sing aloud upon their beds. Let the high praises of God be in their mouth and a two-edged sword in their hand to execute vengeance upon the hidden and punishment upon the people, to bind their kings with chains and their nobles with fetters of iron, to execute upon them the judgment written, this honor have all saints. Praise ye the Lord. You are praising God and there's a two-edged sword in your hand. From your mouth, a sword appears in your hand, and you are executing vengeance. Those that be attacking you, attacking your career, family members, enemies. God is saying, as you praise him, he will confound them. He will destroy them in Jesus' name. To bind kings. Kings are great men, evil men, men that are highly demonic, men that are highly fetish. He said to bind kings with chains and their nobles with fetters of iron. Every demon, every babalawo, mamalawo, every evil person. You see that as you praise God, as you praise him, he will bind them with chains. He will throw them into the pit and they will not come near you in Jesus' name. So in the next 2 seconds, say, Father, thank you. Say, thank you, Jesus, because we are praising him. We are executing those vengeance now. We are executing vengeance. Say, Father, in the name of Jesus, I say, thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank him. Now, thank you for what you are expecting. I thank you for the visa. I thank you for the new job. I thank you for speed. I thank you for my husband or my wife. Pray that prayer. Those things, thank him. I thank you for open doors. I thank you for canceling depression, for canceling any form of confusion. Thank him. I thank you, Lord, for helping me to pass my exams. I thank you, Jesus, for helping me to pass that interview. I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord, for removing every embargo, for removing every delay. I thank you for my babies. I thank you, Lord, for open doors and open heavens. So shall it be in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Next thing, I have these new verses. Okay, the verse of the day, God is spirit and his worshippers must worship him in spirit and in truth. And of course, you look at Psalm 145, 3 to 7, we talk about the splendor of God. You are not praising a common man, you are praising God. You see that when they eulogize kings, you see that they had their hearts and their heads swell. Same thing with God. When you eulogize God, you ascribe his name, you are the King of Kings, you are the Lord of Lords. God just comes in and domiciles in your atmosphere. Just look at David. Now, the next thing, how to get your prayers answered, is to come before God with boldness. Hebrews 4:16, he said, let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. When you come before God with boldness, you get mercy from him and grace. Many of us here, when you go into your parents' room, are you scared? If I go to my parents' house now and I go to their room, I'm not scared. I can enter there how I want. I don't have to be like, oh, daddy and mommy, oh, can I enter? Oh, Lord. No, no. But a visitor or a stranger, I cannot do that. A stranger cannot just go to my parents and say, hey, I want to enter. Are you all right? Is it... You have to go upstairs first and I enter the room. No. You are a child of God. So you come before God like a father, like God is your daddy, he's your father. He wants the best for you. God is not wicked. Announcement. God is not wicked. God is not trying to punish you. People see God as a tax master. They see God as an evil person. God is loving. God is caring. God is a daddy. God is, he loves us so much that he does not want anything to come near us. A woman can forget her suckling child, but not God. So I want to let you know that when you come before the throne of God, pray boldly. See, I'll just say, Father, I thank you because you hear me. Pray with understanding. Pray with boldness. When those guys came to the beautiful gate, Peter, I think it's Peter and John, and they told that man that was lame, he said, that silver and gold, I will see me I have. But what I have, I give unto you in the name of Jesus. Rise up and walk. What happened? They prayed that prayer with boldness. So when you come before God, pray with boldness. If you are living in sin, it's hard for you to pray in boldness because you know yourself that God is not going to answer that prayer. I've been there before. Where you have not seen, he said, God. But I've learned something from Kenneth Copeland. He said, anytime he sinned, you say, Father, I judge myself. I judge myself. Have mercy on me and forgive me, and I judge myself. And begin to come before God with boldness. May God help us in Jesus' name. In a long time, I went somewhere, and I think the person got my order wrong. And I think that thing just pissed me off because I think I confirmed. I said, is it the order? The person said, yes. And the person, it's not something that you know have lost me. And I got angry. And I felt bad later. I said, Kai, Shiro, you're a man of God and you're getting angry. Mm-mm. I told myself, you know, I'm seeing it now. I just come before God with boldness. So the second way to get your prayers answered is to pray with boldness. Come before God with, like, it's your daddy. Daddy, this is what you said. And I'm coming before you. Thank you. It is done in Jesus' name. Amen. Next thing, keep exercising your faith. Mark 11:23. Truly, I tell you that if anyone says to this mountain, be lifted and thrown into the sea, and has no doubt in his heart, but believe that it will happen, it will be done for him. Any comments so far before we continue? Any comments? Keep exercising your faith. See, God looks at your faith. You know, I will also say one thing. God looks at your mind when you pray. God looks at your faith when you pray. And God looks at your mind. See, when you are praying, you must have heard it before. God is looking at your mouth. He's looking at the words that come out of your mouth. And he's looking at your mind. Many of you pray and your mind is negating your prayer. You are praying and say, I'm not sure if this thing will happen. No. How can it be possible? Bible says with God, all things are possible. Nothing is impossible with God. When you pray, exercise faith. Exercise faith. Exercise faith. Let your faith be strong. Don't believe God for something small. It's an insult. If you come to me and ask me for $5, you are insulting me. Forgive me for saying that. God is so big that you're asking for something small. It's an insult to God. Exercise your faith. Ask for something big. Now, I want you to think about the biggest thing you want God to do for you. Just think about it. Just think it. And believe it is done. Just think it now. You have 5 seconds to think it. You want $1 million. You want $100 million. You want a new job. You want that job to be a remote job. You want a visa in the next 5 days. Ah, God can do it. God can do it. Let me tell you, there are some things you bring to God that God is annoyed. He's angry. He's like, what is this? You're asking me, God, I need 5,000 naira. Ah, God is like, ask for 5 million. May God help us in Jesus' name. You know, I think I heard Daddy Gio was praying one time. He said that he was in the UK. That's Pastor E. Adeboye, please. The General Overseer of the Redeemed Christian Church of God. He said he was in the UK. And he said he wanted God. He wanted £50. I think he said he wanted £50. And he said that one man called, one man that was very selfish, one of his most selfish rich friends. He said that man will never call and give him anything. And that man said, you know what? Take £50. He said another person called again, if I remember clearly of that story, and gave him another £50. And I said, he said if he had known, he would have gone for £100. £150. What am I trying to say? That when you pray, have big faith. Have great faith. Have the faith of God. Have faith that it can be done. I can just pray and say, Father, I thank you that you hear me. I say, Lazarus, comfort. But you can do it. Exercise your faith. You have to go for a car. You have to go for a used car. Father, I thank you for a used 2000 Nissan Maxima. Father, I thank you for a G-Wagon. Has to go for something big. I thank you for a Rolls Royce. Please, guys, I'm telling you something that works. I thank you. Put pictures around. I thank you for a Jeep Wrangler. I thank you for a Range Rover. I thank you for a brand. Hey, you are talking. You are talking. Father, I thank you for a 1995 Mitsubishi Lancer. I thank you for a Mazda 626. I thank you for Golf. Please, don't pray that kind of insulting prayer. God will help us in Jesus' name. Ask for something big. But I thank you for my job. It will be around the world. That's big prayer. Ask for something impossible. Father, I thank you that in the next 3 months, I'm engaged and I'm getting married next 4 months. That's prayer. Hey, you are talking. Thank you, Tesla. I need to go to... For those that are in Nigeria, does that car work? Do you need gems to charge your Tesla? But that should be a good one. I thank you for a nice Tesla. Yes. Ask God for something big. I thank you for a brand new MacBook. Ask God for something big. Let's move on because of time. Exercise your faith. See, when Jesus prayed, he was doing the same thing. Jesus was a son of man. He was the son of man. He was a man of God. When he prayed, he also exercised faith. When Moses came in front of the Red Sea, and God says, you stretch his hand. He did it by faith, my brothers and sisters. And when he stretched his hand, what happened? The sea parted. May every Red Sea part in your life in Jesus' name. May every Red Sea part over your life in Jesus' name. Exercise faith. Ask for something big. Oh, God, I want something small. That is annoying and insulting. See, you can't ask me for something. If you ask me, if you give me a blank check, I will bankrupt you. I'm telling you, because I have big dreams. But you can't bankrupt God. You cannot bankrupt God. Let's move on because of time. Thank you, Jesus. We must pray according to his word. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but God's word will not pass away. I've heard from, I think it's from Kenny Hagin. I think he said you need at least 3 scriptures to back up what you are praying to God for. You are trusting God for money. Haggai 2, the silver and the gold is mine, saith the Lord. Proverbs 10:22, the blessing of the Lord, the maker rich, and added no sorrow. I think God has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant. I think it's Psalm 35 or so. Have prayers and the word of God to back up your prayers. Pray the word of God. Pray the word of God. Pray. You are believing God for a child. Oh, man, there are many prayers for children. Psalm 127, Lord, children are heritage of the Lord, and the fruit of the womb is his reward. Father, I thank you. The word says that children are the heritage of the Lord, and the fruit of the womb is his reward. I thank you. And you can even determine the sex. I thank you for a male child. I thank you for a girl. You can determine, I want twins. I thank you for twin boys. I thank you for identical twin girls. Pray the word of God. Pray the word of God. The word of God is yes and amen. Do you know, I realized that when Elisha and Elijah prayed, just look at Elijah, look at Elisha, they prayed the word of God. They spoke the word of God. They decreed and prophesied the word of God. Pray the word of God. Pray what it is written. Look for scriptures. And Bill Wilson said that when he got his scripture for his private jet, he saw it in the book of, I forgot what scripture, he saw it again. He saw it there, that they will fly or something like that. And he stood on that scripture, and he has private jets. You can also have private jets. J-E-T-S. Private jets. It is possible. I'm going to have plenty. I don't know about you. You know, in my lifetime, I'll be giving out jets like people give cars. I will see someone say, you know what? I have this jet. I have a G650. I think you will need like it. Take it. I give it to you. See? Let's continue. Pray the word of God. Pray the word of God. Pray the word of God. Number five, give. Number five, give. See, when you have prayed, sow a seed. I'm saying things that have worked for me. Thank you. How's this, Sister Olu Abu Salami? How's this? Do you know it's possible? Let me, before I go, pray the word of God. Do you know it's possible for you to have at least three houses? Let me give an example. In 2006, I went for a summer. In the summer, I think my parents took us somewhere for the summer, somewhere in South Atlanta. And that person now took us to somebody's house. They had a beach home. That's the first time I was seen a beach home. A house near the sea or near the river. They had a boat. Ah! They had their own house somewhere in the city. They now had a beach home. It's possible for you to have at least two houses. And I heard from a woman of God, Sister Felix Adejumo. She said, the amount of children you have, you should have houses for all of them. If you have five children, have five houses. So when you are gone, they're not fighting over one house. Please. If you're going to have 10 children, have 10 houses. Oh, the house in New York, that's your own. The house in London, that's your own. The house in Lagos, that's your own. The house in Abuja, that's your own. The house in Bangkok, that's your own. The house in New York, that's your own. Everybody have your own house. Pray big. God is said to do great things. Give, 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 give. See, I realize that when you want to move the hand of God to act swiftly, you have to sow seed. And that seed will be painful. The seed will be painful, but I'm telling you that when you give, you are giving your heavenly account. The Bible says, whatever you bind on earth is bound in heaven. Whatever you lose on earth is loose in heaven. A seed will leave your hand, but it cannot leave your life. Luke 6:38, he said, give, it shall be given unto you. Good measure. Press down. Shake it together. And running over, shall men give unto your bosom. What if you should I give you an example? Well, let me give it. In the year 2020, during COVID, I think I came to Nigeria. I was in Nigeria, and I sowed a seed. I think I sowed a seed, Daddy Gio. I think I also met with Pastor Leke, sowed seed. So my boss now sent me a message that he wants to see me. And I was very nervous because during the year 2020, they were laying off people. You know, because of COVID, a lot of people lost jobs and a lot of, they were downsizing. So when my boss scheduled the meeting, I was like, God, please, may they not fire me. And the man told me, he said that we have given you a raise. I said, what? I won't tell you the amount, but it was in thousands of dollars, ladies and gentlemen. From the seed that I sowed, that was very painful for me. God brought more money than I can ever imagine. He said he gives in batches. Hey, you can't beat. See, I read in the book of 2 Kings, chapter 3, verse 26, 27. I'll summarize it. They came to find the king of Edom, the king of Israel, the king of Judah, and another king, and the king of Edom. I think of Moab, but they came to fight that king. And he tried and tried, and they were beating that king badly, soundly. They were beating him badly. They were beating him soundly, like the king of Moab. Do you know what he did? He took his firstborn and killed him. Look at it in verse 27. He took his firstborn and sacrificed his firstborn as a sacrifice. God, hands off. God promised the king of Israel and the king of Judah that they will win that battle. He promised them, and they were already winning. But the king of Moab did something very crazy. He took his firstborn that will take over from him and killed him. And God said, you know what? No. Look at this. He said there was great indignation against Israel. So they departed from him and returned to their own land. They were going to kill the king of Moab and he sacrificed his son. God respects sacrifice. That's a very negative sacrifice. But you see what I'm saying? That God respects sacrifice. I am telling you, ladies and gentlemen, that if you want to change levels in the realm of the spirit, especially financially, you need to give, and you give on good ground. Give on good ground. Don't give on useless ground. Don't give on ground that we waste. Don't give people that are, see, my motto, my mantra, when I'm giving on good ground. I'm not wasting my seed. I can't be wasting seed. It's too precious. May God help us in Jesus' name. What am I trying to say? Give. When you have prayed, you have praised God. Put a seed. Sow a seed. It can be $5. It can be $1. You can be picking up. There's one time I was praying somewhere and I picked up trash. That's my old seed. I picked up trash. I saw trash. I picked it up. And God gave me something. He said something I will never forget. And I wrote it down in my other book. And God showed up for me because I needed it. May God help us in Jesus' name. Number six, forgive. 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 Please, if you have comments, talk. It's like, let me just talk. Forgive. The Bible says in Mark 11:25, and when you stand to pray, if you hold anything against another, forgive so that your Father in heaven will forgive your trespasses as well. Matthew 6:14. For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will forgive you. If you forgive men their trespasses, what will happen? Your heavenly Father will forgive you. Please. Any comments so far? Any comments? Any
Someone questions? Has a question. Someone has a question.
How do you know a good ground to sow? How do you know? People can also answer for me. How do you know a good ground to sow? First of all, you see results. You will see results. Like in a couple of ministries now. I'm just giving an example. You will see results. You will just see that I sold $2 before and I have $5. You will see results. Sister Temi, go ahead. Temi T.
Yes, yes. To answer that question, the way I look at it is this.
Mm-hmm.
What I've heard is a very good formula to use is to sow in the direction you want to go. So if you are looking at your life, you are examining your life, you have seen somebody else who is excelling in the areas that you want to excel in. Maybe they have godly children and you want godly children. You sow into that life. One of my favorite cheerleaders of dreams, Teresa Valfoy, she talks about how for years she was believing God for a child. And what she would do is like she would host baby showers in her house and use that as a seed to sow for children. And if you see, she has only one child, but that her daughter, she looks like a model. She's very beautiful. So you sow in the direction you want to go into. So if you look at examples in your life, even preachers that you're looking at and you're saying, okay, they have wonderful children, or people that have businesses that you want to have in the future, you sow into where you would like to go. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very, very much. Thanks, Brother Peter, for that comment. Very true. Sister Temi hit that nail on the head and hit it big. You sow where you want to go. See, you can see a woman that has... I had one lady say, she said that a woman had... She wanted twins. You see, before she got married, she saw a woman that had twins and she sold it to that woman. Like, hey, I just want to give you this gift. But she tied that gift to the fact that the woman had... And now she has her own twins. So you can see even a regular person that is operating in a realm that you're not operating in. And the best thing for you to do is to sow into that person to reap what they have. May God help us in Jesus' name. That's how I can explain it. And Temi does hit it on the head. I don't know if it's Tamayo or you, Rachel. I don't know if you want to say something. But that is so important. You sow into a place or into a person where you see results. Results speak. This person is operating in a different realm, in an anointing that I don't understand. Father, I want this. Give it to that place. This person has good children, has great children. I want great children. Bam. A man of God, before he got married, he did not have a car, and God told him to sow into a man and buy tires for the man's car. Does that make sense? Man is using his leg to be trekking. Another man has a car, and God told this man that he's trekking to sow into a man that has a car. Today, if you go to that man's garage, that man has so much cars. See, when God is asking you to sow, because God is opening a vista that you don't know. It's opening a vista that you can't understand. There's one time when I sold $5, $10, and I was opening that realm. When God has to start sowing thousands of dollars, God is saying that you are praying in the realm of thousands of dollars. When God says you start tuning ten thousands of dollars, God is saying there's a realm. See, God is opening a new vista. He's opening a new vista. He's opening a new vista. But it's up to you to enter into that vista. So it feels like God is taking from you, but God is saying, no, 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 I'm pulling you higher. Sister Oluwabu Solami.
Yeah, praise the Lord. For me personally, how I check out the good soul to sow is, firstly, the leading of the Holy Spirit. I want the Holy Spirit to lead me. That, oh, I'm not just saying, oh, everybody is sowing into Kenneco Plan Ministry, so me too, I want to sow. No, I want the Holy Spirit to lead me specifically to where He wants me to sow, pertaining the time and what I need, like Sister Timmy said. So when the Holy Spirit leads me, that's what now where I'm going, okay, all right, I'm sowing here because I've been led. It's like you saying a place called there. God is sending me here. That's okay. Or when you sow here, this is where your harvest is at. I don't just want to sow elsewhere because I know that, oh, this person, just like if I probably want finances and all that, right? I can sow into Kenneco Plans Ministry, sow into Bill Wisting and all that. But I also want to listen to God to know where exactly He wants to sow a seed at the particular time. Last week, I feel like, was it last week or last 2 weeks? Last 2 weeks, I think something like that happened. I needed an answer. Like, I needed a speedy answer. And I began to check within my spirit, like, God, I know that I've been taught by You that when I need something done right, I need to put the seed in the ground, aside from the seed of the word, but like a seed that harvest can come through that. And I was just in my car and Jerry Saville just came up and he was talking about God is into speed. I said, yes, this is the answer. And I immediately called his ministry. I sowed a seed in there. And in 2 days, my answer came. So I also want the Holy Spirit to lead me. Did I know that Jerry Saville usually, like, you know, favor works in his life, extraordinary. And I know that, yes, he always says that God is into speed. But I made sure that God led me to sow in there. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Thank you very much. Thank you so much. Thank you very, very much. Thank you. I like Brother Peter. He says that you can sow by serving, example, Elisha. Very true. He poured water on the hands of Elijah. You can sow by sacrifice, example, Pastor Debo. Anybody, Bishop Edekpo, any, just give different examples of men of God. You can sow by riches, example, Solomon. See, in the end, please, nobody's trying to collect money from you here on this platform. We don't give offering here. What I'm trying to say is that your giving will open doors for you. Your giving will open doors. I'm telling you, I've tested it many times. It's so true. See, when God wants to change your level, He will change your level of giving. You can't stay the same and expect big. Stupidity is doing the same thing and expecting a different result. Same thing in the realm of the spirit. I mean, you are trying to get to a higher realm. You will have to give your way out of where you are right now. And everybody has given great examples. Gift in the life of what, of who you want to be or where you want to go. I let the Holy Spirit guide you into who to sow to. I can give different examples. There's one time I in Nigeria came to Alabama, and man, I emptied my account, and God, it is well. Next one, forgive. This forgive part is easier said than done, and I'll just be honest with you. Forgiveness is easier said than done. You can tell somebody to forgive, but when it comes to you, it takes the mercy and the grace of God to do it. I hope I can bear witness with some people here. Round up the next 2 minutes. Sorry, I've gone over time now. Forgiveness takes the grace and the mercy of God. You know, we had a fast in our church, and I was about to fast. I know one thing about fasting is that when you come before God, God will show you who you are. I want to let you know that when you pray, God reveals you to you. When you are given to prayer, when you are given to the word of God, when you are given to fasting, God will reveal you to you. You think you are doing well until when God reveals you to you. I'm telling you, you'll be shocked. When God will say, this thing you are doing, you know it is wrong. And you're like, I didn't know that. So I was about to start the fast, and God said that, Shion, you are still resentful. I said, resentful, okay. Somebody did something to me that I did not like. And I thought I had forgiven the person, but God was still telling me that I still have some resentment against that person. So, for my fasting to be accepted, I had to ask God to help me to stop being resentful. Many of us are forgiving, but we are still resenting some people. You are forgiving them. I mean, you don't, because Bible says if you don't forgive, nobody will forgive you. Or God will not forgive you. So yeah, just if you already like forgive. And God says only slap you, turn the other cheek. Although it's not something I will do, I will block you. I know myself. So I don't retaliate. I would not walk away for the place. So I just you know. So God revealed that to me. I had to ask God to help me. Ladies and gentlemen, your prayers cannot work if you have not forgiven completely. It's easier said than done. If somebody swindled you and took money from you, if you know, I forgive. No, it takes the grace of God to do it. If somebody cheated on you, somebody lied. And many of us, if you have lived long enough, people have offended you. And you have offended people too. You too have offended people. But you have to forgive. Forgiveness is the antidote to stagnancy. Forgiveness is the antidote to stagnancy. Forgiveness is the antidote to stagnation. May God help us in Jesus' name. So if there's somebody that's offended you, somebody stole your boyfriend, somebody said something very negative to you, you know, some things that people say that you remember 10 years, 15 years after, maybe your daddy said something very negative, your mother said something, or maybe you were molested. I'm not trying to bring up some, you know, these are deep, deep points that people don't talk about. Or something really negative happened and it's still in your heart. God is saying that he will give you the grace to let go in Jesus' name. Just ask God, say, Father, I ask you for help. Have mercy on me. And I pray that God will help you in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Please, for your prayers to work, you need to forgive. I know, it's, as I said, it's easier said than done, but the grace of God will help you to do it in Jesus' name. Amen. I think that's all I got. Is that it? Now, I put there, finally, your prayer should not be self-centered. Your prayer should not be self-centered. Me, myself, and I. Father, I thank you for myself. I thank you for my job. I thank you for my wife. I thank you for my children. I thank you for this and that. Prayer, kingdom advancement prayer. Matthew 6:33, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. That's even a secret for answered prayer. Kingdom advancement prayer. Pray for your pastor. Pray for me. I need prayers. Pray for me. I'm serious. Pray for PPC. Pray for your parents. Pray for your general overseer. Pray for the head of your church. Pray for your president. Your prayer should not be self-centered. Your prayer should seek to bring people into the kingdom. Pray for souls that need to be won. Sometimes I even pray for sick people in my family. I pray for everybody that is sick in this area. Let them be healed in Jesus' name. I pray for somebody that is going, you know, people are going through pain. They lost a loved one. They lost a spouse. They lost a child. For those that are grieving right now, Father, please help them in Jesus' name. Pray. Don't let your prayer be only self-centered prayers. Pray kingdom advancement prayers. Pray for the souls that you have won. Pray for souls that are yet to be saved. Pray for that person that is not saved yet. Don't ask amiss. Don't pray prayers that, Father, I thank you because when I get this money, I will show people that you have answered my prayers. I will show off. You are acting amiss. Pray. Don't let your prayers be self-centered. A man of God, Pastor Yadiboye, said that when he asked God, God asked him, what do you want for your birthday? He could have asked for a car. Father, give me a brand new car. He said, God, I want a miracle for every person that you have put under my care. If that's the answer, I believe. I want a miracle. And God said, you know what? Start a program called the Holy Ghost Service. Don't pray self-centered prayers. Let me tell you, too, the prayers that are easily answered are prayers that you pray for the advancement of the kingdom. The Lord, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy what? Thy kingdom come. Prayer of thanksgiving, prayer of kingdom and family prayer, that will be done on earth as in heaven. Then give us this day our what? Our daily bread. Our daily bread came almost at the end of the Lord's prayer. He prayed thanksgiving prayer. He prayed kingdom advancement prayer. He prayed the will of God before he started praying his own. Your prayer should not be self-centered. Let me tell you the truth. 30-day challenge. I want to pray that prayer. I'm giving myself 30-day challenge. Don't pray for yourself. Pray kingdom advancement prayer. 30-day challenge. It's hard for me to. Don't pray for yourself. Pray kingdom advancement prayers. I think I'll end there. Any comments before we round off? Any comments? Any comments? I think we are done now. Any comments? Contributions? Any comments? Man, we went over. Sorry, guys. We are 15 minutes over. Oh. Any comments or contributions? Any comments or contributions? No comments. Any comments, contributions? Okay, let's pray.
I want to ask something. Sorry.
Okay, yes, Amaya.
Because I love this message. It seems it's very good. It's a recipe for if you're not getting your prayers answered, do this, 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 this. Make sure you've checked these off. But you might come across a problem that does not necessarily respond to all those things. And this is where you kick into long suffering. And I know sometimes people make jokes about patience and they're like, oh, don't ask God for patience. He'll give you a problem. But the Bible says it's with faith and patience that we inherit the promise. So after you've done everything, the Bible says you should stand therefore. So you've prayed, you know God wants you to have something. You've gone through the checklist like Pastor Victor has walked us through today. And then all you have to do is just stand until you see the results. If you don't have the results, you did not stand long enough. So I just wanted to just throw that in there. But thank you. Wonderful message.
Thank you very much. Very true. With faith and patience, you inherit the promise. The many times you pray, you've praised, and you're just waiting. God is still working. It's hard to wait. But let me tell you, another option would be the wrong option. Abraham waited and waited and waited and waited and waited. And he went on his own option. And what do you see today? Ishmael is still disturbing us till today, till tomorrow. And God has blessed them. They are blessed. Go to the UAE, go to the United Arab Emirates, go to the Middle East. Those guys are blessed. They are blessed because they are still the seed of Abraham. But Israel is the original seed. Israel is more blessed. So when you are not patient enough to inherit the promise, I'm telling you that your own will be counterfeit. Your own method will be fake. Your own method will not... You are trusting God for his spouse. God, I can't hold my body anymore. Let me tell you, it's best to be asking God to help you hold your body than to enter into a wrong relationship that will thank you, thank your destiny, thank your career, thank everything, and give you even more of a negative prayer request. May God help us in Jesus' name. Just keep standing. So you have done everything. You have given. You have sown seed. You have prayed. Ask God for them. And ask God to talk to you. Just have a conversation with God. Have a honest conversation with God. Daddy, what's going on here? Let's talk. Bible says, come, let us reason together. What's going on? Is there something I'm not doing? You know, there was one time I got tired of where I was. I got tired. I was in Nigeria. I came for, I just came. I had vacation time. I just decided to come to Nigeria and just chill, which is very weird. So I was in a redemption camp. And normally, if you come to the redemption camp, any time of the day, they are always praying. So I came out. So I will sleep all day. Maybe I will sleep. Then in the night, I will come out maybe 2 a.m., 1 a.m. I will walk around the old auditorium and pray. One time I walked around the old auditorium and I prayed like a madman. Who thought I was mad? You know, it comes to a point where you just say, God, either this mountain will move or you are. Something has to give. Something has to give, man. I prayed like a mad person. Even people that were praying thought I was mad. But I got tired. May God help us in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, let's go. Keep the time. Sorry, guys. Now, let's pray. Father, we thank you. We worship you. We bless your holy name. We give you the glory and the praise. Just ask God that God will help us. Father, help us and let your name be glorified. Help us to do your will and let your name be exalted in Jesus' name. Father, have mercy. Have mercy on us. Have mercy. Have mercy. Have mercy. Have mercy, Lord, and let your name be glorified. Let's just begin to lift up our prayer request like we said in the beginning. Father, we thank you for helping us. We thank you for your help. We thank you for your help, Lord. Let your name be glorified. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen and amen. If you have not given your life to Christ, just say, Father, have mercy on me and forgive me. Wash me in your precious blood. Forgive me, Lord. Wash me, Lord. If you have backslidden, say, Father, forgive me. Have mercy on me in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Sister, take me over to you. Thank you.
Glory to God.